Now, so let's get right to the news. Joining me here in New York, Brooke Sutherland of Bloomberg Opinion, Michael McKee, Bloomberg International Economics and Policy Correspondent, and from Miami, Catherine Rooney-Vera, Baltic Head of Strategy and Research. Mike, I want to start with what Germany is doing. This is like, here's the money, open the door.
The Schwarzenegger is no at this point. The black zero, their balanced budget requirement, out the window this morning. Christine Lagarde challenged Eurozone countries to step up on the fiscal side, and Germany saying today, challenge accepted, which is a surprise to a lot of people because they were seen as kind of the holdouts, the ones who wanted to hold the line. These initial proposals are basically designed to keep people working. The proposals include allowing companies to defer billions in tax payments, extensions of loans, lots of money from the state-owned bank to companies in order to keep people on the payroll. The lower house of parliament has passed a law, and it's going to go through the Bundesrat later, enhancing powers to provide financial support to companies who might be in danger of losing employees. The economist minister, Peter Altmaier, saying no healthy company should go bankrupt because of corona and no job should be lost. So that's the bottom line from Germany. Mm. The other line, as you just mentioned, is Olaf Scholz, the finance minister, saying that they could do a stimulus program. One of the problems for a lot of countries, and we're seeing this a little bit in the negotiations over the U.S. package, is nobody knows how much damage is going to be done to the economy, so nobody knows how much stimulus is going to be needed on the other side. And so you may see people a little more reluctant to do that at first, but in the meantime, they're going to put in place whatever they can to try to keep people from losing their jobs and credit crunches taking companies down.
Catherine, I mean, this is really what markets have been waiting for, is this kind of tone. Is it going to be enough? Have we reached the bottom here, and are we going to start to see things turn around?
Yeah, Alex, and I agree with Mike. I think these fiscal monetary policy measures are intended to bridge the gap from panic to stability. But what's going to get us to stability is uniquely science. So if we get this virus and this panic and this maximum contagion, which we're living in right now, if it lasts beyond another month or into the summer months, then we're talking a whole new ball game. So one of the things that I've been thinking about and hasn't gained much traction, I'd love to get also Mike's take on this, is what President of the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston, Eric Rosengren, mentioned just in the past week, which really hasn't gained traction, which was his idea of at least giving some monetary surprise. Monetary policy, of course, will not fix the problem. But if you were to shock the markets with congressional amendment to the Federal Reserve Act to allow the Federal Reserve to buy a variety of assets, that I think would be something that would give the jolt to the markets to get us kind of more into a more stable trend, you know, stability or higher. And I'd like to get your thoughts on that as well. Yeah.
Well, I think it would take a while to get done, first of all, because the Congress doesn't move that quickly. The Fed really doesn't want to open the Federal Reserve Act, because then any kind of proposal, and you know, there are a lot of people in the Republican Party who want to do audit the Fed and things like that, then that all goes on the table. So it may be harder to get that through than you might think. But at this point, the shock and awe may come in just the Fed's reaction. You might see that if they decide to do an emergency cut ahead of Wednesday. And the reason I'm saying that is you look at what the Fed did yesterday with the repo operations. This morning they just finished the first operation of offers, and only $17 billion was taken up by dealers. So it looks like a lot of what this is about is confidence. And the Fed and other central banks telling markets were there and making people feel a little bit better.
Catherine, what do you expect from the Fed next week or even earlier?
Yeah, Alex, I think the market doesn't care anymore. Honestly, Mike and Alex, I think 100 basis points taking us to zero is already completely discounted. So they're going to do it, and the market is going to yawn or move lower. So we have to get a shock and awe beyond just cutting interest rates and increasing asset purchases, which really, as I mentioned, isn't the resolution to the problem. So we are going to get 100 basis points. That's my view. If the Fed doesn't deliver 100 basis points, which, as I mentioned, is completely counted in, then you're going to get a market freak out. You're going to get a temper tantrum, as we saw back in the taper tantrum. So that's what I'm expecting for the next week. I think that you can make money in these levels of volatility. Options are particularly interesting to us at current levels. And Alex, I'll add one more thing. I maintain my conviction that this period of time will prove to have been a time to accumulate assets. So I think we need to be looking very clearly for opportunities over the next month.
And we'll get to that in just a second. I just wanted to break down some more headlines for you. So the German finance minister Olaf Scholz now saying it's possible Germany will need to take on added debt, as they're saying that they could implement a stimulus program if needed with these timely and targeted measures and could actually maybe take stakes in some corporations. They also want to give other EU countries a budget flexibility too. Is this the beginning of MMT? I mean, but before you laugh at me and be like, MMT is a fringe monetary theory, whatever. But like, seriously, like, is this basically what we're seeing?
Well, no, you have to disconnect this from MMT because MMT postulates that a country that can print its own currency need never worry about going broke.
And that wouldn't be this.
Germany can't print its own currency.
But so the fact they're going to take
that.
Yeah.
No, this is the Growth and Stability Pact that the Eurozone nations have that prohibits them from spending more, from having a deficit larger than 3% of their GDP. And they're at this point look like they're willing to suspend that. I mean, they're not actually calling for it to be amended out of the treaty, but they're going to go around it, and the European Commission will likely nod and wink to that at this point. It's interesting that Scholz is saying other countries should have this because it's basically telling people we are the pillar of fiscal rectitude, and if we're going to let that go, you should feel free to as well.
Well, do you think the U.S. is going to take that message, though? I mean, are we going to see this kind of stimulus for small, medium businesses in the U.S., maybe going back to term asset-backed securities loan facilities like we saw in the crisis? I mean, are we going to see the Treasury step up in this way?
Hard to say at this point. It looks like what they're going to do is put in place, at least the House bill that's being negotiated, and we're supposed to hear more about it this morning. The House bill is designed to keep people at work, provide loan guarantees and perhaps tax credits to companies that might get into trouble in order to keep people on the payroll. The idea of stimulus, additional spending, is being discussed, but not really part of this legislation. Mm-hmm. They're going to wait. The problem we have in the United States is we are just so divided that it's going to be harder to get something through Congress than in other places.
So, Catherine, final word on this to you. You mentioned, you know, you do want to be taking on risk. Where?
Look, I think what Brooke and Mike were talking about could bring another leg lower for the markets. So if you get this division and, you know, the Democratic House putting a lot of pork into their proposal to deal with the coronavirus, you know, Trump rejecting it, the president coming with a payroll tax cut that the Democrats reject, this is not discounted. I mean, the markets could move lower if we get this political brinkmanship with both parties eyeing November 3rd. So I do think we're going to see leg lower. When we do, I'm going to be recommending in the equity investors to look at broad index. You see a lot of names, very strong names in sectors that have also declined with, you know, with ones that really should, which are airlines, cruise ships, transportation, consumption names. But I do like the S&P 500. I mean, multiples are hard to determine at current levels because we don't know the underlying, right? We don't know what earnings are going to be this year. But I do think that just S&P, or you can play the spread between S&P and Europe, are trades that I'll be looking to recommend over the course of the next month.
All right, Bloomberg's Mike McKee, thank you very much. And Catherine Munivera of Bultic, we'll be sticking with Brooke and I. I mean, now Jeff Curry, Goldman Sachs, Global Head of Commodities Research. Goldman sees record crude surplus and inventories building by April. Also, Catherine Munivera of Bultic with us as well. Catherine Munivera of Bultic still sticking with us. Hey, Catherine, when you hear headlines like that from the European Commission, when you basically talk about the central bank being like, we're here, we're there, we're doing stuff, what's your takeaway?
I mean, it's necessary, but it's not going to change the dynamic of sentiment at home. I think about it this way, Alex, you or I, if we have payroll tax cut, for example, or we have lending rates at zero, is that going to make us go out to a restaurant or to the movie theater or to even work if we fear of contracting a virus and bringing it home to our children, right, or to our parents? So I really think these are Band-Aids and bridges. but they are not resolutions. Resolution, of course, has to come from, you know, the health sector, science, the virus debilitating by the summer months. So that's really, I think, where the crux of the issue is. We could get, as Brooke was asking about airlines, we could get, you know, stimulus from the government in the terms of some form of bailout. We've even heard over the course of last night, European airlines basically saying, hey, we need some help. That could come in what form, subsidized loans or the like, something similar to what President Trump announced in his infamous speech from the Oval Office for SMEs. So I do think airlines are going to need a bailout. It's likely going to come in that sector rather than the cruise sector because it's more of a national security issue. And if you let one go and consolidate to two, then you deal in terms of airlines, of course, major airlines in the U.S., then you come into antitrust issues. So I think that could be in the offing, and that would be positive for market sentiment at least.
Catherine, when you talk about this fear factor, there was a fascinating story in the New York Times talking about Chinese being concerned about whether or not they were going to get paid by their companies, whether suppliers were going to get paid. If you look at the U.S. and that fear factor exists, what does a recovery look like?
Yeah, I mean, I think if it could be V-shaped if the duration of the panic is a few months. If this is an event-driven shock, Brooke, then it really should, over historical precedent, last within a six-month time frame. If it exacerbates or gets protracted, then, of course, we're talking about a more sustained recession. I think 2Q U.S. growth is for sure going to be negative. If it's beyond that, I think the market is... pricing in a U.S. recession for sure. But you could get, rather than destroyed demand, delayed demand in a V-shaped recovery if we get a debilitation of the global virus sooner rather than later. One thing that I'm looking at, and I'll add too, is the high yield index. We've got a quarter of the high yield index under severe pressure. So high yield has blown out. I think that's a very good indicator of where we stand in terms of panic or dissipation of that panic. Once we get those defaults, which many of our are expecting, that's when I think you'll see value in high yield.
All right, Catherine Rivera-Bultick, you're going to be sticking with us. We'll talk more credit in just a second. Catherine, to you, you just mentioned high yield before and maybe opportunities at some point. Wrapping in what Noel was talking about, where are the opportunities? Where can you take on some risk?
Look, the high yield index has blown out. And as I mentioned previously, Alex, about a quarter of it is highly vulnerable, which means that we are going to be seeing, of course, from energy sectors, particularly non-conventional funding issues, as your previous person mentioned, but defaults. And that has not yet been fully priced. In addition, you expect bond ETFs to have to sell. So there's going to be additional downside in that space. But as I did mention, at some point, there will be value. And I think that some point is post-default and after the ETFs have to sell. High yield is, of course, a similar asset in terms of movement as U.S. equities. So if you see a blowout in both and expect some recovery, as I do, by potentially year end, then you do look for value in both sectors.
Which then leads us full circle back to energy. Jeff, we know we're going to see sort of a decrease in U.S. production and a pickup in decline rates. How many defaults are we going to see, or is it going to be more sort of targeted M&A in the space here in the U.S.?
Yeah, I think your point about targeted M&A, I think, is a point that's being overlooked here. When you look at the top five U.S. energy companies by market cap, they only produce 20% of U.S. shale. The other 80% is produced by the bottom 50 companies in terms of market cap. That's a lot of those high yield names. They don't do it very economically. And so the key issue here is this the event that's going to kick off that consolidation that we've been looking at for quite some time. If consolidation ends up being the answer, then a lot of these assets get bought out, then the debt associated will end up being paid off as well. So that's the tug of war that I think that the credit markets are facing with is fault on one side and then consolidation on the other. The industry is in really bad shape right now. It's unhealthy. We've been arguing for consolidation as being really one of the key themes for 2020, and we think it's definitely this event really starts to push it that direction.
All right, everybody, thank you so much. Really good conversation on the intricacies there. I know Hebert of Bloomberg Intelligence, Catherine Rivera of Bultick, and Jeff Curry of Goldman Sachs, always good to catch up with you as well.